Praise the Lord. I welcome you to our Sunday worship service. And I praise the Lord for all the Lord has done, all the Lord has taught. And the touch of the Lord is already on your heart and on your life. And I pray that as we get into the Word, the blessing of the Word will enrich your life in Jesus' name. Why don't we pray together? Father, we thank you for this hour. Thank you for this time. Thank you for your people. Thank you for their faithfulness in coming together to worship you. I'm asking, Lord, that our worship today will be a blessing to everyone in Jesus' name. And the blessing of your word and the blessing of obedience to your word will come upon every life in Jesus' name. Bless us, Lord, one and all. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Today we're looking at Psalm 1. Very familiar passage of scripture. I will read him from verse 1 all through to verse 6. Please open your Bible in Psalm 1, reading from verse 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. And then in verse 2, it says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. In his law does he meditate day and night. Verse 3 says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Now verse 4 tells us of the other man on the opposite side that walks contrary to God, that has not given his life, his heart unto God, that is still walking in the way of sin. Says the ungodly are not so, the unrighteous are not so, the sinners are not so, the scoffers are not so, the ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. And in verse 5 it says, therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners, nor the ungodly, nor the scoffers, in the congregation of the righteous. And then concluding verse in verse 6 tells us, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. It's in that psalm, actually the opening psalm, the first psalm, in all the 150 psalms you have in the Bible. And this introductory psalm is like, number one, a preface of all the psalms. Number two, it's like a total panorama of all the other psalms. That is, it tells us the details. As you look at the psalms, it talks about the righteous and it talks about the unrighteous. It talks about the godly and it talks about the ungodly. It talks about the people that are upright and the people that are not upright. It talks about the believers, those who trust in the Lord and those who have not put their trust in the Lord. All the psalms tell us of the actions of those righteous people and of the believers that have trusted in the Lord, of what their possibilities are, what their promises are, what the glory of God is upon their lives. And then on the other hand, it talks about the people, the punishment of those who are not on the side of the Lord. It talks about their way of life, the unrighteous, the ungodly, the sinner, the scoffer. It talks about the punishment that will also come upon them. And so as you come to Psalm 1, you're coming to a, like a summary, like a preface of the preview of what you are going to have in all the Psalms. And today we're talking about the blessedness of the righteous here and hereafter. The blessedness of the righteous here in this world, the righteous is blessed. And hereafter, after death, after the rapture, after we're going to be with the Lord, the righteous will also remain in the blessing of God. The blessedness of the righteous here and hereafter. There are three things we're looking at as we look at this psalm. Number one is the picture of the blessed man, the portrait of the blessed man, the one that God says, no matter what happens, no matter where he lives in any part of the world, this man is going to be blessed. What's the portrait of that man? What's the picture of that man? How can you fit into the picture, into the portrait of such a man that is a blessed man. Number one, then, the picture of the blessed man. Number two is the prosperity of the Bible-believing man. This is the man that takes the word of God, the Bible. He takes the utterances of God, the commandments of God. He reads them. He meditates on them. He walks on them. He observes them. He does them. And because he's a Bible-believing man, a Bible-believing child of God, a Bible-believing woman, because of that, all his life, all her life, all his decisions, all her decisions, everything he does, everywhere he goes, every moment of the day, every moment of time, he depends, she depends on the word of God, a Bible-believing man, a Bible-believing woman, what prosperity that person will have. And now point number three talks about the portion of brutish men, the portion of people who act like beasts, like brutish people. They don't put God in their thoughts. They don't put the Creator in their thoughts. They act like they don't understand why they are here, who brought them here, who has put them here to do something glorious and something wonderful, because they're brutish men. The people that do not take God seriously, they don't have anything to do with this word or with the Bible or with believing the Lord. They have their portion here on earth that God himself has ordained, and they have their portion also on the other side of the grave in eternity. Number one, the picture of the blessed man. We're coming back to number one now. As we look at number one, we're reading from verses 1 and 2 of this Psalm 1. Psalm 1, verses 1 and 2. Blessed is the man. Actually, in the original, it says, blessed is that man. It pinpoints him. It identifies him. It says, you are looking for a blessed man, I will show you. You're searching for a blessed man, I will show you. You want to interact with a blessed man, I will show you. And you want to walk with him and live with him, and you want to look at his example and look at his portrait and say, that is what I want to be. Blessed is the man, blessed is that man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor seated in the seat of the scornful. As you look at that verse 1, it describes him negatively. What he does not do, where he does not walk, where he does not stand, and where he does not sit. That is, he does not walk in every way, he does not walk in every path that is before him. He looks at that, he says, this way, this road, this path, that's the way of the ungodly. I'm not going to walk in that. He does not stand in the place of sinners. He says, the people who stand, do they stand at that corner of the street, or do they stand anywhere? That's the place the sinner stands, and he makes up his mind, I will not stand there. He does not sit in the seat of the scornful, in the seat of the drunkard, in the seat of people who are almost mentally deranged, and they are not following after the way of the Lord. He says, that is the seat of the scoffer. That is the seat of the scornful. That is the seat of the people that blaspheme God. I will not sit there. But now verse 2 describes him positively. First of all, negatively, now positively. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. His delight, his joy, his will, his passion, and his enjoyment, his excitement is in the law of the Lord. And in his law, that is in that law of the Lord, does he meditate day and night. And let's join verse 3. It says in verse 3 here, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. It's a refreshed tree, it's a fruitful tree, and it's always a beautiful, it says, is planted there, is stationary there, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, his leaf also shall not wither. And what whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Looks like I'm talking about you. You'll be the blessed man and the blessed woman in Jesus' name. Now, as we look at this picture and this portrait of the blessed man, there are three things we should look at here. Number one is description. How do you describe him? How do you describe that blessed man? How do you describe this man that heaven says is going to be blessed? Whatever is happening on earth, whatever is not happening on earth, this man, this woman, this boy, this girl is going to be blessed. Number one is description. Number two, his delight. What he delights in is joy, is excitement, is passion. What really interests him, his delight. And then number three is deeds. Is deeds. What he does, whatsoever he does, is this. Let's look at number one, his description. How do you describe him? Blessed is a man. Here's his description. He does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. They are ungodly people and they talk a lot. They talk too much. They talk in various ways. They want to offer you an advice. Before you take the advice, before you even examine the advice, before you ruminate and think over the advice, I want you to say, is this a godly man? Is this a righteous man? Is this a follower of Jesus? Does this person have the light? Does he have the light of the Lord Jesus Christ? If he does not, if he's ungodly, you're not even going to examine the counsel or the admonition, because here is your description. If you're a child of God, you do not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. You do not stand in the way of sinners. You see sinners standing together. Those sinners are discussing, we're going to do this, their plans. It's when they stand together, they kind of put forward their plan. It is when they stand like that in their discussion and in their deliberations and in their debate or whatever it is they're doing, they stand there and you look at them, that's a sinner, that's a sinner, that's a sinner. He has not been born again. He's not refreshed in the word of God. He doesn't know the Lord. Whatever his status in life, whatever his position in life, whatever he claims to be his experience in life, you will not stand in the way of sinners, nor seated in the seat of the scornful. The people that even now outwardly, openly, dramatically, they scorn the word of God, they scorn the way of heaven, they scorn the narrow path that leads to eternity, they scorn even the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, they scorn everything that you hold dear. As a child of God, you will not sit with them. You will not sit in the seat of the scornful. Look at the description of this blessed man in Psalm 32. In Psalm 32, reading from verse 1, he's talking about the man that is blessed. And he says, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven. There we are. You know, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And if we're going to think of the people who are unbelievers, if we're going to think about people who are number one, ungodly, number two, they are righteous, number three, they are sinners, number four, they are scorners, number five, they are scoffers. If we're going to think of the people who do not know the Lord, who do not have the Lord, who do not have the way of the Lord, they are just like every common person. They have sinned. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, we turn away from our sin. We turn away from our transgression. We turn away from every evil thing we have done. And in that confession that comes out of conviction, we confess and then we turn totally and we repent. Our sins are forgiven when we believe on Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. We believe on Jesus Christ, our substitute. We believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, our sin bearer. And then our transgressions, all of them together, bundled together, they are totally forgiven. And the sin is covered away from God's sight. You'll never see them again. That's why it says the man we're talking about, who is the blessed man, the picture of the man we're painting, the portrait of the man we're describing, the blessed man is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Look at verse 2 there in Psalm 32, verse 2. It says, because his sins are covered, because his sins are taken away, look at this, the Lord does not impute iniquity unto him anymore. Blessed is that man. Blessed is that woman. Blessed is that believer. Blessed is the one who have taken all the sins, bundled them together, confessed them, and turned away from them. And he believes and he rests on the blood of Jesus Christ, the blood of the Lamb that takes away the sin of the world. He rests in that to cleanse all the sin, and to put every sin away, and to put everything in the gates of the sea, that they'll never be remembered against him anymore. Blessed is that man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. After he is saved, after he is born again, after the sins are forgiven, is also set free in his spirit, in his mind, in his soul. And it says, there is no guile now, there's no unrighteousness now in his spirit. It tells us about this man in Psalm 119, Psalm 119, reading from verse 3. The blessedness of the man and the glory of the man, the goodness in the man, in Psalm 119, reading from verse 1. It tells us in verse 1, it says, blessed is the man. This is the blessed man we're talking about. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. These are the people, now they are already blessed. They are children of God. Their sins are forgiven. Their sins are cleansed. And the word of God is taking effect in their lives. And they are undefiled in the way. And they walk in the law of the Lord. They walk in the word of the Lord. They walk in the revelation of what God had revealed, that this is how a believer ought to live. If any man is in Christ, is a new creature. All things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. And he tells us about this man in verse 2. In verse 2 it says, blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. They are not coming to God with a superficial attitude. They are not coming to God with half-heartedness, but their whole heart, their whole mind, their whole soul, their whole love, they devote to seeking after the Lord. And then he says in verse 3 about these people, he says, they also do no iniquity. They are born again, and they do not continue in sin. They are born again, they are children of God. And they also do no iniquity, because they walk in his ways. They walk in his ways. In Luke chapter 11, verse 28. Luke chapter 11, reading from verse 28, we have the words of Jesus Christ himself about the people that follow after the Lord, about the people that take the Lord to be their Savior, to be their Redeemer. But he said, yea, rather, blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. Blessed are they. It's not just that, okay, I've heard the word of God, that's not enough. If we are going to be blessed, if I'm going to be blessed, our blessing demands that we hear the word, we meditate on the word, we deal the word, we decide on the word, and we keep the word of the Lord. Finally, as you come to Revelation chapter 22, the people who are going to be blessed eternally, the people who are going to be blessed when we get to the other side, here is what the Lord is saying. He says, blessed are they that do his commandments. There are people who think that all I need to do is raise up my hand at the crusade, raise up my hand when the altar call is made, and then I said I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and they do not actively, they do not proactively, they do not positively obey the word of God, and they think heaven is okay for them, heaven is going to be sure for them, just because they raised up their hand sometimes. But it says, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. If we're going to enter in, and we're going going to get to the kingdom of God, here is what the Lord demands, that we're doing the commandments of God. We have the grace, we have the love, we have the desire, we have the mercy of God, we have the cleansing of the blood of the Lamb, we have the strength that He has given us by the Holy Ghost, and we do those commandments. That gives us the description of the man that is blessed. Number one is description. Let's come to number two now. His delight. His delight. And it tells us in Psalm 1, reading from verse 2. In Psalm 1, reading from verse 2, it says, his delight is in the law of the Lord. In this law does he meditate day and night. He delights in the word of God. He delights in the way of God. He delights in the will of God. He delights in the wisdom of God. Look at those words. Number one, he delights in the word of God. It says there's no word like this word. The word coming from heaven, the word of the revelation of the Lord. It says, my delight, my joy is in the word. Not only that, he delights in the way of the Lord. There is no way like the way of the Lord, the way that he has mapped out, and he says, walk ye in it. You're going to find rest for your soul, walk ye in it. You're going to find the fulfillment of the promise of God, walk ye in it. He delights in the way of God because there is no way like God's way. He delights in the will of God, and the will of God is revealed in the word. It's revealed to us. You see, there's the will of man, there's the will of the sinner, there's the will of society, but no, he doesn't take that. He says there is no will as pure, there's no will as good as the will of God. Because of that, he delights in the will of God. He delights in the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God is revealed unto us. And of course you understand, of course you know, there is nobody as wise as the Almighty God. Not even Solomon, not any philosopher, nobody on earth. Therefore he says, the wisdom in which I delight in is the wisdom of the Lord himself. He delights in the word, he delights in the way, he delights in the will, he delights in the wisdom of God. Look at Psalm 40, and I'm reading from verse 8. Psalm 40, and we're looking at verse 8. It says, I delight to do thy will. It says, I'm after the will of God. I pursue the will of God. And it's in that will of God I delight. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. It tells us in Psalm 112, and reading from verse 1. Psalm 112, reading from verse 1. It says, praise ye the Lord, blessed is the man. That's what we are pursuing, and that's what we want to feed into. I want my life to feed into the life of a man that is blessed by heaven, blessed by God, blessed by Christ, and blessed by the promises of God, and blessed by the Holy Ghost, and blessed every time. When you pray, you are blessed. When you read the word, you are blessed. When you live, you are blessed. And it says, here is the delight of such a man who wants to be blessed at all times. Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighteth greatly. Look at that. He joins that word greatly. It's not only that he's just delighting superficially in the word of God, superficially in the way of God, superficially in the will of God, superficially in the wisdom of God. He delights greatly in his commandments. Verse 6 tells us something of that same psalm. It says, surely it shall not be moved forever. It says, such a person, the blessed of such a man, of such a woman, of such a boy, such a girl, is that as he's growing older, as she's growing older, the winds of the world, the waves, or the storms of the world will not move him. Why? Because his bliss, his delight is in the word of the Lord. Surely it shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. Look at verse 7. Verse 7 is wonderful. It says, he shall not be afraid of evil tidings. Look at this, look at this. His heart is fixed, trusting the Lord. His heart is fixed, believing the Lord. His heart is fixed, obeying the Lord. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. It tells us in Job chapter 23, and I'm reading from verse 12. In Job chapter 23, we're looking at verse 12. It says, neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. What do you think about that? Job said, I might be going through some challenges, but there's something I will never take my heart away from. There's something I'll never take my eyes away from. And there's something I'll never take my confidence away from. It says, neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. You know how much we delight in good food when we're hungry? You know how much we delight in the morning in God, in food, because we're hungry, want to take our breakfast? You know how we delight in taking supper, because I must end the day by, you know, taking supper. But this man is saying, I delight in the word of God so much. And the word of his mouth is more than my necessary food. What he's saying is saying, no Bible, no breakfast. I will read the Bible. I will meditate on the Bible. I will take in the word of the Lord in the Bible. No Bible and no breakfast. And what's he saying? When he says, I delight in the words of his mouth more than my necessary food, he's saying, no scripture, no supper. I'm going to have the scripture. And then after that, I'm going to have supplication as well. I'm going to depend upon the Lord. Obviously, such a man as this will be blessed. This is the picture of the blessed man. We've seen his description. Number two, we've seen his delight. Now we see his deeds, the deeds of the blessed man. You know, if we're going to be blessed, we must do something and must keep on doing that thing so that the blessings of God will be flowing into our lives from the inexhaustible river of the blessedness of God. We're looking at Psalm 1, verse 2. It says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. And then in verse 3 now, it says in verse 3 that he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. It's like a tree planted by the rivers of water. The psalmist is looking at different things. The love of God as a flowing river. The grace of God as a flowing river, and the mercy of God as a flowing river, and the power of God as a flowing river, and the strength of God as a flowing river. And he says, this man, he shall be like a tree that is planted by the rivers of water, is planted by the grace of God, is planted in the love of God, is planted in the mercy of God, is planted in the strength of God, is planted in the might of God, because he is so planted in the rivers of water. That's why he bringeth forth fruit in a season, and his leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth, that's his deeds, whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. That's why the word of God encourages us every time, we must be doers of the word. In James chapter 1, we're reading from verse 22. In James chapter 1 verse 22, it says, be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. We must be doers of the word, because that's how we're going to be blessed in our deeds. In fact, it says in James chapter 1 verse 23, in James chapter 1 verse 23, if any man be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man beholding his natural face in a glass. And then in verse 24, it says, in verse 24, for he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. Look at verse 25 now. Be a doer of the word, be a doer of the word, but whosoever also looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continues therein. He hears the word, he continues. He meditates on the word, he continues. He plans his life on obedience to the word of God, and he continues. He continues therein. He being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. A doer of the work. A doer of the work. Look at this. This man shall be blessed in his deeds. This man shall be blessed in his need. And actually, that is how God answers our prayers, because we're doers of the word of God. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 22, 1 John chapter 3, reading from verse 22, it tells us in 1 John chapter 3, verse 22, it's telling us about how God answers our prayer. When we know that we are based on the word of God, we are confirmed on the word of God, and we are totally established on the word of God. Open your Bible, 1 John now, chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 22. It says, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Why? Because we keep his commandments. That's the blessed man. And when your prayers are answered, aren't you blessed? When God gives solution to your problem, aren't you blessed? It says that whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And then he tells us in verse 23, he says, and this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his son Jesus Christ and love one another as he gave us commandment. Then verse 24 says, he says, and he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him, and hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he has given us. By the Spirit which he has given us. And now we come to point number two. We've seen the picture of the blessed man. Now we're going to see the prosperity of the Bible believing man. The Bible believing man, that's the blessed man. The Bible believing man, that's the born again man. The Bible believing man, that is the one that bases his life and his behavior and his action and everything he does, he bases everything on the word of God. The prosperity of the Bible believing man. And we're looking at someone, and we're looking at verse 3. Looking at someone and looking at verse 3. It says, and it shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. It's planted by the rivers of water. It's like he has foundation. It's like he has sustained foundation. It's not like he's there today, it's not there tomorrow. It's not like he's planted there and then he's uprooted the following week. And then it's by that river, every week, by a different river. No, he's like a tree that is planted by the rivers of water. He has a sustained foundation. And then it goes on to say, that bringeth forth his fruit. He bringeth forth. He makes an effort. He bringeth forth, and faithfully is doing all they ought to do, so that fruit will be coming out every time. That bringeth forth his fruit in a season, is steadfast about it in bringing it forth, is steady about it in bringing it forth, and is committed to it every time in bringing it up. He has a steadfast faithfulness, and then his leaf also shall not wither. His leaf also, he'll be evergreen. He'll not feel the drought, he'll not feel the famine, he'll not feel the effect of a changing climate. He brings forth his fruit in a season, and is leave also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. He is fruitful, is bringing forth fruit every time. As we look at that verse 3, I'm looking at three things. Number one, his sustained foundation. Number two, his steadfast faithfulness. Number three, his satisfactory fruitfulness. Come to number one. We're looking at Psalm 1 verse 3, the first part there. He shall be the blessed man. He shall be the born again man. He shall be the devoted man. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters. He has foundation. He is planted. It's not just a tree that just came up by itself. He is planted. Look at Psalm 92, reading from verse 12. Psalm 92, I'm reading here from verse 12. It says in verse 12, the righteous shall flourish like a palm tree. It shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. And then in verse 13, those that be planted. You see that word? You may want to underline that word in your Bible. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They are planted in the house of God. Why? In the house of God, that's the house of prayer. Why in the house of God? That's the house of power. Why in the house of God? That's the house of mercy. Why in the house of God? That's the house of love. Why is he planted in the house of the Lord? That is the house where God operates. That's the God where God moves. The creator of the heavens and earth is stationed there and is walking there. And this man, blessed man, is planted in the house of the Lord. And he shall flourish in the courts of our God. Shall flourish in the courts of our God. In verse 14, it says in verse 14, they shall still be bringing forth fruit in old age because they are planted. It's not the age that matters, whether they are young or they are old. They are planted. They are planted in the house of the Lord. They are planted by the rivers of water. And because they are always planted there, that's how they will be bringing forth fruit. Even in old age, have you found some people? They say, I'm getting old now. I don't have to attend Bible study all the time like I used to do. I don't have to attend the revival hour like I used to do. I don't have to read my Bible like I used to do. If there is any time you should read your Bible, it's when you are getting older. If there's any time you should be in church, it's when you are getting older. If there's any time you need to remain planted by the rivers of water, it's as you are getting older, because then you are nearer heaven than 50 years ago. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. They shall be fat and flourishing. And then it says in verse 15, it says, to show that the Lord is upright and he is my rock. That ought to be your testimony. He is my rock and there is no unrighteousness in him. Jeremiah chapter 17 tells us in verse 7. Jeremiah chapter 17, reading from verse 7. It says, blessed is the man. You know, David has spoken about the blessedness of the man, and then other parts of scripture, blessedness of the man. Jeremiah the prophet now says, blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord. He trusteth in the Lord, whose hope the Lord is. Whose hope the Lord is. Is never hopeless. This man is blessed. Look at the portrait of the man. Look at the prosperity of the man. And look at the promise that is given to the man. The Lord is his hope. In fact, it says in verse 8, it says, for he shall be as a tree planted by the waters. The same thing. It shall be as a tree planted by the waters. It's refreshed every time. It's fruitful every time. It's bringing forth fruit every time. And whatever changes are all abroad does not get to him, does not get to her, does not get to this tree that is planted by the waters, that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when heat cometh, but her leaves shall be greener, and shall not be careful, shall not be anxious in the year of drought, in the year of famine, neither shall cease from yielding fruit. He never ceases yielding fruit. He keeps on yielding fruit. Why? Because he is planted on the foundation, and it's a sustained foundation. It tells us that foundation in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11, it talks about the foundation. It says, there's no other foundation, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. You understand? It will say, is planted by the rivers of water. I told you already, the river of the peace of God, and Jesus is our peace. The river of the love of God, and Jesus is the manifestation of that love. And the river of the mercy of God, and Jesus is the manifestation of that mercy. And the river of the forgiveness of God, of the goodness of God, and Jesus the foundation of everything. And it says, if we're going to have that sustained foundation, be planted in Christ. Abide in Christ. Remain in Christ. Be secured in Christ. The sustained foundation, that's the foundation Jesus Christ Christ our Savior. That's the foundation, Jesus Christ our Sanctifier. That's the foundation, Jesus Christ our Healer. Jesus Christ our Redeemer. Jesus Christ our Deliverer. Jesus Christ our Baptizer in the Holy Ghost. Jesus Christ that is made redemption, is made justification, is made sanctification, is made everything for us, is all in all for us. Therefore, you are planted in Christ. You abide in Christ. Without me, ye can do nothing. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, that's the reason why, because it's on that foundation, that's why it's faithfully yielding forth, faithfully bringing for fruit every time. That brings me back to someone, and we're looking at his steadfast faithfulness, as his steadfast faithfulness. Someone now, verse 3. It tells us about this blessed man. It tells us about this man that is planted by the rivers of water. It talks about he bringeth forth fruit. He bringeth forth fruit. That means the fruit is not just coming by itself, just automatically. He's doing something. He's bringing forth. Is acting it out, is obeying the Lord, is doing what he ought to do. And as a result of that, it will be like the tree that is planted by the river, is faithfully bringing forth its fruit in its season. That faithfulness, my brother, is what you need. That faithfulness, my sister, is what you need, that you are steadfast about it. You are not saying today, maybe I will not bear fruit today. The fruit of a good deeds that the Lord has called you to. Maybe I will not do anything today, but you know, the tree is there and is planted by the waters, by the rivers of waters. And every time and every day and every season is bringing forth the fruit. That's what it should be. Now let's look at Mark chapter 4. In Mark chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 14. In Mark chapter 4, verse 14, says, the sower soweth the word. The sower soweth the word. And because the word is sown in your heart, all the wayside, you dig it up again so that you will not sow by the wayside. All the land that is filled with pebbles and stone, you gather up the stones and you cultivate that land, and the stones and the thistles that are there, you rake everything up so that the word of God falls into fertile ground. And then it says now the kind of fruit you are going to bear. In verse 20, it says in verse 20, and these are they which are sown on good ground. These are they which are sown on good ground. It is giving us another picture now. It's talking about the seed. It is sown in your heart, it's sown in my heart. And day and night you meditate, day and night I meditate. And because we meditate on that word, it says now it's bringing for fruit. Because our heart is good ground, our mind is good ground, our intelligence is good ground. Where the word is planted, where the seed of the gospel is planted, is good ground. And then it says, he receiveth it, and he brings forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60-fold, and some 100-fold. It says in different areas of our lives, we're bearing fruit. In different areas of our life, we're bringing for 30-fold, we're bringing for 60-fold, and we're bringing forth 100-fold. It says in John chapter 15, John chapter 15, talking about the fruitfulness of the believer. In verse 2 here, it says in John chapter 15, verse 2, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. The Lord Jesus Christ talking about the Father. He says the Father is the husband man, and is the one that is evaluating, is the one that is looking at the vineyard. And he says every branch in him, everyone that professes to believe in the Lord and is not bearing fruit, and he thinks that, you know, empty religion is what's necessary, empty righteousness is what's going to do, every empty reformation is what's going to do, and is not looking at the fruit he ought to bear. He says, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. He wants us to bring forth fruit and to bring more fruit every time. Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, I am the vine and ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Underline those words. He that abideth in me and I in him is not a person like a rolling stone, like that gathered slow moss. It's not like he's here, he's a wanderer, he's here, he's there, he's everywhere. He abides, he's stable, he's dependable, and he remains on that foundation. He's on a sustained foundation. He's planted and he remains there by the rivers of water, and he says, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. Actually, he tells us in verse 16. In verse 16, he tells us the reason why he chose us. He tells us the reason why he has selected us. He tells us the reason why we're members of the body of Christ, where we're children of God. He says, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit shall remain. That ye should go and bring forth fruit, that your fruit shall remain. That whatsoever ye shall ask the Father in my name, he may give it you. He wants us to bear fruit. And when we come in connection with the Lord, married unto the Lord, and connected totally with the Lord, every time with the Lord, there's no choice. We're going to bear fruit. It tells us in Romans chapter 7, verse 4. Romans chapter 7, reading here from verse 4, is telling us what our connection with Christ will do, and what our connection with the Lord will do. That if we're fully connected with him, if we're really totally connected with him, we're going to bear fruit. It says in Romans chapter 7, reading from verse 4, wherefore, my brethren, wherefore, children of God, wherefore, the people who have tasted of the goodness of God, of the grace of God, the people who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb, who have been cleansed in the blood of the Lamb, the people that God said, come out from among them, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord. It says those people who are brothers and sisters, members of the family of God, and who follow after Christ, and who have of the grace of God. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the Lord by the body of Christ, that ye should be, look at this, that ye should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. We're married unto Christ as Savior. We're married unto Christ as sanctifier. We're married unto Christ as baptizer in the Holy Ghost. We're married unto Christ, our Lord, our King. And he says the reason why we're married to him is that we should bring forth fruit unto God. We're looking at the prosperity of the Bible-believing man. Number one, he has a strong foundation, a sustained foundation, an established foundation. A foundation that is not shifting, and he himself is not shifting from that foundation, the sustained foundation. Number two is steadfast faithfulness. He's faithfully bringing for fruit all the time. But the question now is, what kind of fruit is he bringing forth? Number three now is satisfactory fruitfulness. Is satisfactory fruitfulness. We're looking at Psalm 1 and we're looking at verse 3. It says, and it shall be like a tree. Who is this? This is the blessed man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. This is the blessed man who standeth not in the way of sinners. This is that blessed man we're talking about, who does not sit in the seat of the scornful. This is that blessed man who delights in the word of God, who delights in the will of God, who delights in the way of God, who delights in the wisdom of God, and in his word, in his way, in his will, in his wisdom, does he meditate day and night? And then it says, he, that person, shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. And then it says, he bringeth forth his fruit in his season, and his leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. You find in that verse, his fruit he brings forth in his season. What kind of fruit? That brings us to this third part, is satisfactory fruitfulness. We're looking at Matthew chapter 3, verse 8. Matthew chapter 3, verse 8 is talking about the fruit of this blessed man. Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. You profess to have repented, let's see the fruit. You profess to have confessed your sin, and that you hate those sins, and you turn away from them permanently, and you turn to the Savior who has forgiven you, who has set you free. Let's see the fruit. Bring forth the fruit meet for repentance. The fruit that's according to your repentance, and the fruit that aligns with your repentance. Didn't you say, Lord, I'm sorry? Let's see the fruit of that being sorry. Didn't you say, Lord, I'll not go that way again? Let us see the fruit that goes along with that repentance. The fruit meet for repentance. It means what you were before, you are no more. You were in darkness before, no more in darkness. You were doing evil before, no more evil. You were in a gang before, you are not in that gang anymore. You are now a new creature in Christ, and your life is totally new. Your life is totally renewed, and your life is now righteous in the presence of the Lord. And what you do in secret, and what you do in the open, everything is according to the word of God, and everything goes along with your repentance. Bring forth therefore the fruits meet for repentance. It tells us in Romans chapter 6, reading from verse 22, the kind of fruit will bring forth. When it says, but now being made free from sin, we're born again, being made free from sin, we're now abiding in Christ. It says we're made free from sin. The blood of Jesus has cleansed us. And if the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. We're made free from sin, and we become servants to God. Become servants to God. We're no more serving Satan. We're no more serving sin. We're no more serving self. We're no more serving the occult society. We're no more serving the powers of darkness. We're no more serving demons. We're no more serving the enemies of righteousness. It says now we become the servants to God. Look at this. Ye have your fruit unto holiness. When he talks about satisfactory fruitfulness, he's saying that we're bearing fruit, the fruit of repentance, the fruit of righteousness, and the fruit of holiness, and the end, everlasting life. Actually, he talks about the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. That's the fruit, and we're bearing that steadily. We're bearing that steadfastly. We're bearing that solidly. We're bearing that openly. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace. There is joy in our heart now. We don't wear long faces and gloomy appearance as if, you know, the old world is on us now. As if our condemnations are not gone. As if all our guilt is not gone. As if we're not free from the yoke of the past. As if we're carrying all the problems of the world on our back. But now it says, because we are planted by the rivers of waters, the promises are ours, the prophecies are ours, the precepts are ours, the word is ours, the power of the Lord is ours. Because of that, we're bearing the fruit of repentance. Because of that, we're bearing the fruit of righteousness. Because of that, we're bearing the fruit of holiness. Because of that, we're bearing the fruit of love and joy, excitement. We're happy serving the Lord, and we're bearing the fruit of peace. There's peace in our heart, there's peace in our home, there's peace in our surrounding, and were the agents of peace, were the ambassadors of peace, because we know we're all to be bearing that fruit. We're bearing that fruit all the time, and we bear the fruit of peace as ambassadors of peace. We're bearing the fruit of long suffering. We're not easily discouraged, easily tired, that, you know, I don't like that, I don't like this, I don't like this, always complaining about everything. We cannot even suffer. We don't even have short suffering, if there's any word like that. But it says the fruit we bear is the fruit of long suffering at home. No divorce, no separation in the community. There's no conflict, there's no confrontation, because we have the fruit of long suffering and the fruit of gentleness. There's no harshness, there's no hardness, there's no oppression, and there's no, you know, pugnacious spirit. Gentleness. We're gentle to little children. We're gentle to our wives. We're gentle to our neighbors. And the fruit of goodness and the fruit of faith. And it tells us in verse 23, it says, meekness as well and temperance. Against such there is no law. Against such there is no law. We're coming to Philippians now. In Philippians chapter 1, we're looking at verses 10 and 11. It's still talking about the fruits we bear, the fruit of righteousness that we bear, and the fruit of goodness that we bear. It's saying in Philippians chapter 1, reading from verse 10, that because we're now children of God, and because we're planted by the rivers of waters, and we're planted there, we're sustained there, we're stable there, and we're not moving here and there, we're bearing fruit. The fruit of repentance, praise the Lord, is there. The fruit of righteousness, praise the Lord, is there. The fruit of holiness, praise the Lord, is there. And the fruit of the spirit, of love, of joy, of peace, of long-suffering, and of temperance, of self-control, of meekness, all that fruit is there. And now he tells us in Philippians chapter 1, verse 10, he says that she may approve the things that are excellent, that she may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. Don't forget that word there. Don't overlook that word. Till the day of Christ. Without offense. Without offense. Day after day. One day at a time. Gradually. And as we're moving on, it says we make sure that we're bearing the fruit. Our fruit is not offensive. Our fruit is not going the wrong way in the mind of anyone, because we're without offense until the day of Christ. In verse 11, it says, in verse 11, being filled with the fruits of righteousness. You see, the fruit is talking about, we're filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, unto the glory and the praise of God. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 10. Colossians chapter 1, reading from verse 10, is talking about the fruits we ought to be bearing, the fruit that is pleasing unto God, that she might walk worthy of the Lord, unto all pleasing. Unto all pleasing. You remember Enoch, he walked with God and he had that testimony, he pleased the Lord. You remember Abel, he pleased the Lord in his sacrifice. You remember Noah, he pleased the Lord in his obedience, a building attack. And you remember Abraham, he pleased the Lord and God called him my friend. And he says, with you, the same grace they had, the same love they had, the same devotion they had, the same commitment they had to the Lord, that we you were lead to please the Lord, that she might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Increasing in the knowledge of God. What does that say? As you increase in the knowledge of God, the fruit you are bearing will increase. As you increase in the way of the Lord, the fruit you are bearing will also increase. That's what the Lord is saying. And as we learn more and more, as we pray more and more, as we are connected more and more with Christ, as we abide more and more with the Lord, we're increasing in knowledge, we're increasing in grace, we're increasing in the love of God, we're increasing our consecration, we're increasing in our delight in doing the word of God and doing the will of God, and our fruit also will increase. We've seen the blessed man. Number one, we've seen the picture of the blessed man. Number two, we've seen the prosperity of the Bible-believing man. We come to point number three now. In point number three, we see the portion of the of brutish men. The portion of brutish men. Let's come back to Psalm 1, and we're looking at verse 4. Psalm 1 verse 4, it says, the ungodly are not so. It's like we have this good company of righteous people, gracious people, loving people, merciful people. And then as we're going on with them, we'll say he is blessed, she is blessed, that one is blessed, everyone is blessed. All of a sudden, we'll stop short. And we say, look at that. That one is not like the rest of them. That one is not blessed like them. The ungodly are not so, but they are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. They are not stable. They are not steady, and they cannot remain and abide. They are not like the tree planted by the rivers of water. As the wind is blowing them here and there. The ungodly, the sinner, the scoffer, the blasphemer, the backsliders, they are like chaff which the wind driveth away. It says in verse 5, he's still talking about those ungodly people. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment. The judgment will come, and the great white throne judgment will eventually come. They will not be able to stand. It doesn't say they will not appear before judgment. It's saying they will not have leg to stand. They will not have might to stand. They will not have any reason to give for every evil thing they have done. Their mouths will be shut. There will be no defense for them. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in judgment, no sinners in the congregation of the righteous. And now in verse 6, bringing everything to a conclusion, he's talking about the righteous and talking about the ungodly. And he's saying that their ways are apart, their roads are apart, their paths are apart, and their destinies are apart. Therefore it says, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. The Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. What way is that? That's a good way. What way is that? That's the narrow way. What way is that? That is the way of Christ. I am the truth. I am the way, and I am the life. The Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. The way of the ungodly shall perish because it's not stable, because it's not dependable. The way of the ungodly is like their lives are written on sand. It's like their principles are written on the sand at the seashore. And because of that, their pathway, because of that, their wisdom, because of that, their lifestyle, because of that, their history, everything will be blotted out. They will be forgotten, and their way will be forgotten. The way of the ungodly shall perish. Now, in these three verses, it's talking about three things. Number one, the chaff. Number two, the canal. Number three, the chassis, the gulf, the pitch, the distance between the righteous and the ungodly in eternity. Number one, the ungodliness in the chaff. The ungodliness in the chaff. Look at that verse 4 again. That's in Psalm 1, reading from verse 4. It says, the ungodly are not so, but they are like chaff which the wind driveth away. The wind driveth away. Connect those two words, the ungodly and then the chaff. The ungodly and then the chaff. The way the Lord is using the chaff here is saying the chaff is too light to be stable. And the chaff is so light, the wind will drive it away. The wind will separate that chaff from the wheat eventually. And he's saying that is the ungodly. The ungodly are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Of course, you know that when you peel off what's in the, you know, at the back of the rice or the corn or whatever, and then the wind comes and drives everything away. In Job chapter 21, 1, reading from verse 18, is the nature of the chaff. It's talking about the thing that will happen to the chaff eventually. And in Job chapter 21, reading from verse 18, it says, they are stubble before the wind, as stubble before the wind, and as chaff that the storm carries away. The storm of judgment will come. It will carry the chaff away. The storm of the rebuke of the Lord will come. It will carry the chaff away. The whirlwind of the final judgment of God will come. And when it comes, there will be nobody that will be able to hold that ungodly steady. And to say, stay there, nothing bad will happen. The ungodly will be like chaff that the storm of the judgment of God, the whirlwind of the judgment of God will carry away. We're told in Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5, even from verse 24. Isaiah chapter 5. Reading from verse 24, it says, therefore, as the fire devoureth the stubble, it's talking about the next thing now, after the chaff had been driven away by the wind, after the chaff had been driven away by the whirlwind, after the chaff had been driven by the storm of the judgment of God, here is what will follow. Therefore, as the fire devoureth the stubble, and the flame consumeth the chaff, and the flame consumeth the chaff, so their root shall be as rottenness, and their blossom shall go up as dust, because they have cast away the law of the Lord of hosts. Underline that, because they have cast away the law of the Lord of hosts, because their mind is not in the law. Because their heart is not in the law, because their obedience is not to the law of God. It says, because they have cast away the law of the Lord of hosts and despised the word of the Holy One of Israel. It says that's the reason why that wind will come and drive the chaff away and drive them into fire, and they will be burned. It says in Luke chapter 3. In Luke chapter 3, reading from verse 17, Luke chapter 3, and we're reading here from verse 17. It says, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his flock, and will gather the wheat into his garner. Look at this. But the chaff will he burn with unquenchable fire. That's the end of the ungodly. That's the end, eternal end of the sinner who has not repented and who does not have any delight in the word of the Lord. It says that chaff, that ungodly person, that sinner, it says that unrepentant, prodigal, backslider, it says that scoffer, it says that corner, that will not come back and remain at the center and be planted again in the word of God. It says he'll be like chaff, and that chaff will he burn with fire unquenchable. We'll come back to Psalm 1, and we're looking at verse 5. In Psalm 1, verse 5, it's talking now about the unworthiness of the carnal. The carnal, those who are not like the righteous, and those who are not fit to be in the congregation of the righteous, they are carnal in their thinking, they are carnal in their action, they are carnal in their behavior, they are carnal even in the novels they read, they are carnal as they follow after pornography, they are carnal as they follow after the way of the flesh, and it makes them ungodly. It makes them sinful. It makes them scornful. And it says, therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment. When the judgment comes, when the judgment arrives eventually, the ungodly, the sinner, the scoffer, the scorner shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. You can tell that it's talking about the future, because now the wheat and the tares, they are all together. Now the believer and the unbeliever, they attend the same local church, because the local church and the central church is an open place, and everybody comes, and those who are willing to repent, they come. Those who are not even repenting, they just come over and over as a religious duty, they come, and nobody is going to drive them. But it's talking about the final day of judgment, the final day of reckoning, about the great white throne judgment. And it says, at that time, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. It's talking about the unworthiness of the canal. The unworthiness of the canal. When we say canal, look at the New Testament, a revelation about the word canal, about the people who are canal, and about these people who cannot stand and who will not stand in the way of the people of God. They will not stand at the time of judgment. In Romans chapter 8, verse 6. Romans chapter 8, we're looking at verse 6. It says, for to be carnally minded is death. The chaff are carnal, the ungodly are carnal, the sinners are carnal, the unrepentant scoffers are carnal. And it says, to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Verse 7 tells us, in verse 7 it says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. The carnal mind hates the word of God, hates the doctrines of the word of God, hates the revelation of God, hates the authority of God. It says, I want to go my way. I don't want any God anywhere controlling my life, because he has a carnal mind, is enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. It's not submissive to the law of God, not submissive to the word of God, not submissive to the revelation of God, that this is the only way of regeneration, the only way of redemption, and the only way of salvation. Is not subject to that, neither indeed can be. In verse 8, it says, in verse 8, so then, they that are in the flesh, they are not in Christ. They that are in the flesh, they are not walking in the Spirit. They that are in the flesh, they are not in the Word of God. They are not in Christ as new creatures. They that are in the flesh cannot please God. Look at Romans chapter 7. In Romans chapter 7, I'm reading here from verse 14. So you understand what is saying about the canal and about their unworthiness is standing at the day of judgment and standing with the congregation of the righteous. It says, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. The carnal one is one that is sold like a slave to sinning, and cannot come out of it. Is bound as a slave, is captured as a slave, is serving as a slave, and he cannot retrieve himself, he cannot withdraw himself from the slavery of sin. Sold under sin, carnal. It says in verse 15, here is a carnal, for that which I do, I allow not, for what I would, that I do not, but what I hate, that I do. At times they'll say, I hate it. I don't want to do that again. The life of the drunkard is a miserable life, and I don't want to be like that. But all the same, although he hates what he does, he has no power, because it's like chaff. It doesn't have any weight, doesn't have any value, and doesn't have any grace, and doesn't have the sustaining power of the Lord to do what is right. What I hate, that I do. In verse 16, it says, if then I do that, I would not, I consent to the law, that the law is good, that it is good. But in verse 17, it says, now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Here we are. Christ does not dwell in him yet, and the Holy Spirit does not dwell in him yet, and the Word of God does not abide in him yet. And because he's a sinner, because he's an ungodly man, because he's a scoffer, because he's not the blessed man. He has not been blessed with salvation. He had not been blessed with forgiveness. He had not been blessed with the freedom that he ought to have. He said, sin dwelleth in me. In verse 18, it says, in verse 18, for I know that in me that is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. But for to will is present with me, resolution upon resolution, determination upon determination, decision upon decision. It says that is present with me to will and to say, I will not do that anymore, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. How to perform that which is good, I find not. In verse 19, therefore it says, for the good that I would, I do not, but the evil I would not, that I do. The evil I would not, that I do. You say, what kind of man is this? It's a church man. It's a man always coming to church, but he doesn't have salvation. It's a church woman. It's a woman coming to church every time, reading the Bible every time, but he does not take time to pray and repent and have salvation and have the grace of God and have a new life in Christ. Therefore, he knows what's right. He knows the doctrine. He says, but the evil I would not, that I do. In verse 20, it says, in verse 20, now, if I do that, I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Look at verse 24. In verse 24, it says, O wretched man that I am, the carnal, O wretched man that I am, the sinner, O wretched man that I am, the powerless one who is always dreaming to do what is wrong, and yet he doesn't want to, the slave of sin, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? Thank God Jesus is a deliverer. Thank God Jesus is a redeemer. If you will come to Christ today, never mind all the times you've been coming to church, we're talking about coming to Christ now. Never mind all the time you have been professing, I'm a member, I'm this and that. We're talking about coming to Christ now. O wretched man that I am, O wretched sinner that I am, who shall deliver me? Christ will deliver you. Christ will save you. And if the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free, and free indeed. Let's come now to the final verse of Psalm 1. In Psalm 1, we're looking at verse 6. Psalm 1, we're looking at verse 6. The Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, and that way is different from the way of the sinner. It's the narrow way. Is the way of the Bible, is the way of the gospel, is the way of righteousness. The Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. In every generation, the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. And for every person who claims to be righteous, every person who has come to Christ, the righteous one, and the Lord has turned his life and changed his life, and the Lord has transformed him, and he follows him about, he knows how he talks, he knows how he walks, he knows what he does in the private and in the public, he knows what he does, and he knows his steps, he knows his way, and the Lord knows the way of the righteous. Then you turn to the other side, and it says, for the way of the ungodly, which is totally different, the way of the righteous, which is totally different, the way of the unstable, which is totally different, the way of the people when they are at Rome, they do as the Romans do, and when they are in Jerusalem, they do as the people of Jerusalem do, and they are not stable. You cannot pin them down and say that this is their life. When they were the sinners, they look exactly like them. When they were the scoffers, they look exactly like them. And when they were the unbelievers, they look exactly like them. The way of the ungodly, unstable people, unrighteous people, unholy people, that way shall perish. When those ungodly people perish, their way also will perish. Now two ways, the way of the righteous, the way of the ungodly, and they are far apart, and they will never come together. they are far apart, and they will never cross, because there is a great gulf between the righteous and the unrighteous, between the godly and the ungodly. And once they leave this world and there is no chance to repent anymore, the righteous on the right hand side and the unrighteous on the left hand side, they will never meet again, they'll never come together again, because there's a chasm, there's a gulf, there's a division, and they're far apart, and that chasm is unalterable. We're looking in at Luke chapter 16, and we're looking at verse 26. Luke chapter 16, verse 26. You remember the story of that rich man in hell that told Father Abraham to send Lazarus, for Lazarus to dip his hand in water and touch his tongue and cool his tongue, because he was tormented in that flame. Abraham replied and said, beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed. That's the chasm. That's the division. That's the separation. So that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, and neither can they pass to us that will come from thence. The Lord is saying that on that final day, the righteous will be separated from those who are unrighteous. The ungodly will be separated from those who are godly. The saved, sanctified people of God, obedient people of God, will be separated from those who are saved, unsanctified, unholy, unrighteous, and they'll be forever separated, and that chasm is unalterable. Come to Revelation chapter 22. Revelation chapter 22, and we're reading from verse 11. And you'll see that on the final day, there's going to be the day of judgment, the day of reckoning, that he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. If a man dies unjust, if a woman dies unjust, he'll remain unjust forever. And he that is filthy, let him be filthy still. If a person dies filthy, defiled, sinful, unforgiven, he will remain filthy, defiled, sinful, unforgiven forever. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. If a person dies saved, sanctified, holy, righteous, he remains saved, sanctified, holy, and righteous. He that is holy, let him be holy still. And now in the next verse, that's in verse 12, he says, and behold, I come quickly. The Lord is saying, I come quickly. And as you can see the signs in the sky, you can see the signs on the earth. He is coming, and his coming will not be delayed. He says, behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. According as his work shall be. If he's a blessed man, he reward him like that. If he's a blessed woman, he reward him like that. But if he is ungodly, if he's unrighteous, and if he is a scornful man or woman, he'll be rewarded just like that. Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. And then in verse 13, it says, I'm Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. In verse 14, it says, blessed are they. Here is a man again. Here is that woman again. The saved one, the righteous one, the sanctified one, the one that is abiding in the mercy of God, abiding in the grace of God, the one that is planted by the rivers of waters, the one that is meditating and delighting in the word of the Lord all the time, and the one that is walking according to the way of the Lord. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city. And while the righteous will enter in enter in and now inside the city of God, inside the kingdom of God, and they are forever and ever in paradise, in heaven. Look at what will happen to the other people in verse 15. In verse 15 it says, for without are the dogs, the righteous have entered in, without are the dogs, the saved have entered into the city of God, the righteous are without, they are outside, the people who are planted by the rivers of water, the people who are blessed, the people who are saved, the people who are righteous, the people who are walking according to the way of the Lord every time, they have entered into the kingdom. But now without are the dogs and the sorcerers, and the sorcerers, and the whoremongers, and the adulterers, and the murderers, and the idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie, they'll be outside. You have your choice to make. If you're already a child of God, be planted by the rivers of water. If you're already a child of God, keep on meditating on the word of God. If you're already a child of God, be the blessed man that you're bearing fruit every time, the fruit of repentance and the fruit of righteousness and the fruit of holiness and the fruit of the Spirit and the fruit of divine presence in your life. Let the fruit be there all the time, because the ungodly are going to suffer forever and ever. But I'm praying for you, and you should pray for yourself, that you will be the blessed man, you'll be the blessed woman, you'll be the blessed boy, saved, sanctified, holy, righteous, and you're delighting in the word of the Lord, and your mind is there in the word of the Lord every time, and you are stable, you are solid, you are steadfast, and you are continuing with the Lord every time, whether you are in the home, or you are at school, you are in the place of work, or you are in the church, or you are with your friends, or you are anywhere in the village, on the road, you are abiding in the Lord all the time, and you are very watchful that you are bearing fruit every time. And when the Lord shall come, and when the trumpet shall sound, and when the people of God shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, I pray you'll be among the number in Jesus' name. You know, if it's going to be like that, we need grace. If it's going to be like that, we need the strength of God. If it's going to be like that, we need the backing of God and the support of God. And you need to say, Lord, I want your help more. You need to say, Lord, I need your grace more. You need to say, Lord, I need your stabilizing power and your strengthening power more in my life, grace more in my life. And that's why we're going to pray now, that everything we've learned today about the picture and the portrait of the blessed man, everything we've learned about the productivity and the prosperity of the Bible-based man, that you are going to have it, and then you'll avoid the portion of the brutish man, the portion of the beastly man in the final end, in Jesus' name. Why don't you rise up? Why don't you rise up and concentrate on this now? Hearing the word is not enough. We must be doers of the word, and the word must come from the head and come to our heart and say, Lord, I've seen the picture of the blessed man. Help me, Lord. I'll be that man. The description, I'll be that man. My sins forgiven. I'll be that woman. And I'm walking in the way of the Lord. And I do no iniquity. I'm obedient to the word. I'll be that man. I'll be that woman. Your grace in me, tell the Lord. Your strength in me, tell the Lord. And the firm decision, I will not walk in the way of the sinner. The firm decision, I will not stand in the way of sinners. And the firm decision, I will not take the counsel, I will not sit in the seat of discomfort. The firm decision, I will delight in the law of the Lord. The firm decision, I will rejoice in the law of the Lord. I'll walk in His way, I will take in His word, I will abide in his will. I will cherish the wisdom of the Lord. Tell the Lord, this word of God will be more precious to me than my breakfast, will be more precious to me than my supper. I'm going to take the decision, no Bible, no breakfast. I must read that word. I must take in that word. I must feed my inner man. I must feed my spirit before I feed the body. And before I sleep at night, no scripture, no sleep. No scripture, no sleep. The scripture must still come in again, so that at the beginning of the day, at the end of the day, is scripture, it's Bible, is the word of the Lord that will keep me walking in the way of the Lord all throughout my life. And my deeds, whatsoever I do, I'll think of your word. Whatsoever I do, I think of your commandment. Whatsoever I do, I'll think about what you have ordained for me to do. And I do it in your grace. I'll do it in your strength. I'll do it in your power. I'll do it in your enablement. Lord, help me so that I'll be the blessed man. I'll be the Bible-based man. The Bible-based man. I have a sustained foundation. I'll not be wandering here and there. I'll not be like chaff that is dreaming about and then this congregation at that time, another church, another time, another denomination, another time. They're roaming about from religion to religion, and they're tasting religion like they're tasting palm wine. I'll not be like that. I'll be on the sustained foundation. I'll be steadfast in my faithfulness. I'll have satisfactory fruitfulness in the Lord. Lord, the portion of the British man will not be mine. The portion of the beastly woman will not be mine. But the mind of Christ, the heart of Christ, the life of Christ, I will have. And my destiny will be the destiny of the righteous, the destiny of the redeemed, the destiny of the sanctified holy people of God. The Lord will not reject anyone. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And whosoever will call on the name of the Lord will receive all the strength we need, all the power we need, all the mercy we need, and all the righteousness we need, and all the assurance we need in the Lord. Tell the Lord, don't miss the time of prayer, and believe the Lord now. He has answered. He never pushes away anyone. He never rejects anyone. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord will be answered. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this hour. Thank you for this service. Thank you for what you have revealed unto us. Thank you, Lord, for the picture, the portrait of the blessed man, the blessed woman. We pray, Lord, everyone who has heard today, everyone who has received your word today, will be the blessed person in the Lord in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray that we'll be Bible-believing people, Bible-behaving people, and that we will stand on your word, and Lord, we'll stand on the foundation of Christ. We pray everything Christ has done on the cross of Calvary will be ours in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, we'll bring forth fruit every time, we'll be faithful. Anywhere we find ourselves, the courage to be faithful, the stamina and the backbone to be faithful, and the life of the faithful, you grant to every one of us in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray, we'll keep on bearing fruit, satisfactory fruit. We'll keep on bearing fruit. And we pray, Lord, the portion of the brutish man, the portion of the beastly woman will not be ours in Jesus' name. And when the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise, and we which are alive shall be caught up together to be with them in the clouds. I pray, Lord, my brother there, my sister there, my boy, my girl there, will not be missing on that final day in Jesus' name. Everything we need to be, everything we need to do faithfully, grant us the grace to do it now. Grant us the grace to be at the very center of your will, doing your will every time until you come. And so shall we ever be with you after that rapture has taken place in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray that during this week, the word we've heard will put to practice, and we'll go everywhere, publishing the word, publicizing the word, and preaching the word, proclaiming the word of truth. And this word will bear fruit in our mouth, in our ministry, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for everything you have done. Thank you for your presence with us, your power with us, and everything you have given us. We pray, Lord, this word will work in every life. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.